Good afternoon and welcome to Markets Today. I'm your host, Mbithe Mwema. Today we are looking at the Africa Business Agenda, a report that has been launched by PwC. To help us understand the dynamics there, Mr. Peter Ngahu is joining us. He is the Senior and Regional Partner for PwC in East Africa, as well as the Senior Partner for Kenya. Welcome to the show, Peter.
Thank you.
Fantastic report that you have put out. Please give us an overview of what are you seeing when you're talking about the Africa Business Agenda.
So the Africa Business Agenda is a report that we put together on the back of the Global CEO Survey that we conduct on an annual basis. So on an annual basis, PwC conducts a survey of CEOs globally. This year we surveyed 1,378 CEOs around the globe. We then modeled on that survey, surveyed 171 CEOs on the African continent, spread across 19 countries, to really focus on what they are seeing on the continent in terms of business sentiments, their prospects for growth over the next 12 months, the medium term, that being 12 months, the 3 years and beyond, and also focusing on some of the emerging technologies that are shaping business around data analytics, artificial intelligence, and the likes, yes.
What is the sentiment with regards to global growth as well as Africa growth this time around?
So we've seen, and you'll see in our survey report, that the level of confidence by CEOs, there's a level of pessimism that has crept into the world economy as well as the African continent, although we've seen a much less shift on the African continent in terms of the decline in the level of confidence by CEOs. And globally, we've seen that shift being much more marked than we've seen on the African continent. That being said, the level of confidence on the African continent still remains slightly below the global CEO sentiment average that we are seeing across the globe. Yeah.
This possibly mean that African CEOs are seeing the bottom, or the bottom is near?
When we ask CEOs in this latest survey what their prospects for growth over the next 12 months, and then contrasted that with their prospects for growth over the next 3 years, we see a much higher level of optimism by African CEOs in the three-year period than the global CEOs.
Okay.
So it's interesting, because then when you project it over 12 months, African CEOs are less confident about growth prospects than their global counterparts. But when you then talk longer term, which is 3 years, then African CEOs are much more optimistic about growth prospects for their organizations than their global counterparts. That's an interesting sentiment, and whether that is the perennial African optimism about the future and the long term will pull it through, who knows?
That's what I was about to ask you, because it always feels like when you're talking about Africa, it is the last frontier. There's a lot of potential, but this potential is always in the longer term. And this has been a conversation, or rather a discourse, that has been happening for 10 years. Does this change, or do we just remain optimistic?
I think we have every reason to be optimistic. There are a lot of issues, and you'll see in the survey, and we can touch on some of them. But when you look at the prospects for Africa in terms of its growth agenda, there's reason to be very optimistic.
Okay.
There are challenges, make no mistake about it, but when you look at the growing population, the very youthful population, the transformation that we are seeing in some of the countries, and Kenya is right up there when it comes to innovation, particularly around technology, and it's been ranked very highly globally as well as on the African continent. When you look at the sort of enthusiasm, the innovation capability of particularly the young population that's on the African continent, there's every reason to be optimistic about what will happen.
Okay.
And there are a lot of things that have changed, to be fair, over the last few years since we've been doing this survey. If you look at some of the transformation we've witnessed around fintech, you bring it down to our own country here, and the sort of inclusion that's been driven by M-Pesa and the likes, mobile money, and the innovations that have then been spawned by that platform, then we are seeing that the technology innovations that are going on in the world, if we take that opportunity properly and innovate, we can leapfrog the rest of the world and really get going on the African continent.
Okay.
But that is not to say there are no issues. There are a lot of issues to overcome.
Yes. Growth is still there in the longer term, but then the structural embodiment of this growth is slightly different than it was 10 years ago. Take us through your views when you're talking about data analytics and the impact of technology on businesses in Africa.
So when we ask CEOs globally and also on the African continent, what is the most transformative development that is shaping their business? almost all the CEOs globally and on the African continent, they were quite clear by overwhelming majority that technological transformation is what's really driving business, and they expect that to be what will continue to shape business. So, and when we talk about technological transformation, we talk about things like data analytics. How do we harness data for better decision making? Okay. And CEOs are telling us that we still have gaps in the amount of data that they would like to use to make decisions, whether it's about their customers and consumers' trends into the future.
So that's forward-looking information.
Forward-looking information. All right. When you look at things like artificial intelligence and the opportunity it provides for companies to innovate, to become a lot more efficient, and to be able to innovate around products, decision-making, and how efficiently they run their businesses, it is a real opportunity before you even go to things like drones and how do we deploy drone technology to really drive some of the things that, things like healthcare, and there are markets that are already on the African continent that are already deploying drones to solve some of the healthcare problems in terms of delivery of medicines in remote areas. There's a huge opportunity there.
Okay.
Things like chatbots and things like robotic process automation. Yes.
So what I hear you saying is, if I'm an African business, my middle line is really going to be driven by operational efficiencies that are leveraged on technology.
As one of the areas,
yes.
The operational efficiencies, because you need to be efficient to be able to generate the values, the value that you need to generate,
okay.
To reinvest in your business so that you can
business.
Grow.
Right.
Because if you're not efficient, then other competitors will come out of the blues and run you out of town.
Okay.
So you have no choice.
You have absolutely no choice.
You have no choice, yeah.
But I like that even in your own report, you're saying middle line operational efficiencies are largely dependent on technology. But then on the upside, on the top line, what is driving growth? Your report does bring out the element of mergers and acquisitions and looking for new markets and looking for new consumers. How does technology actually drive this top-line growth?
It's an interesting question. What we've seen is a combination of things. There's organic growth, companies seeking to grow organically, and depending on which sector you are in, then you may look to first grow organically before you start to look to expand.
Okay.
We are then seeing other sectors where CEOs are very focused on exploring new markets, whether those are their immediate markets. So for example, if you're in Kenya, you start thinking about what are the options that I have in Ethiopia, for example. As opposed to maybe going too far away. There are others who want to venture. Intra-Africa trade, I think, is going to continue to shape what African businesses are going to be doing.
Okay.
So, and that is why I think when you look at some of the top of the mind concerns of CEOs, things like policy uncertainty.
Policy, all right.
You know, goes right up the scale of concerns of CEOs.
And this is what governments are deciding with regards to the business environment.
Yes, and what CEOs are asking is not to be able to drive that policy formulation, although business has a role to play, is to have some level of certainty as to what policy formulations will come in the future. Because one of the things that businesses don't want to deal with is uncertainty.
But Peter, that sounds ideal on paper, but when you actually go to the ground and look at African governments, it's very hard to demystify what the legislators will do. How do you actually weather that kind of uncertainty?
It's a valid point, but when we've also seen countries on the African continent that have been able to do it much better than others.
Okay.
So there's clearly...
So
if you look at places like Mauritius, places like Botswana, that's two countries that have been stable enough in terms of policy formulation. I think, you know, there are lessons to be learned across the African continent, and then there are many more. We are learning. Kenya can do it, absolutely.
Okay.
It can do it. If you look at the ease of doing business and the way we've reformed the country in terms of ease of doing business and jumped up the world rankings, it says that, yeah, we know what needs to be done.
Okay.
We just need to get on with it. And I think there are enough people around the patch to be able to help us drive that agenda.
One risk factor is policy and what is happening in that regard. What about elements such as funding, government deficits, and overregulation and taxes? How do you look at that?
Those remain risk factors, but when we conducted our survey of CEOs and asked them what are the things that concern them the most, the things that came top of the list were policy uncertainty, skill gaps, and regulation as the top three concerns of CEOs. So it tells you then, of course, macroeconomic indicators and, you know, GDP growth rates and as well as debt levels will be things that will feature eventually when you're assessing your growth prospects.
Okay.
But in terms of what's of immediate concern to CEOs, those are the three things that they're most worried about. Of course, they don't operate in a vacuum. If the economy is moving in a direction where there's instability in currency, where debt levels are spiraling out of control, those will inform the confidence with which businesses will do business in future. But at the moment, when we surveyed them in this last survey, those are the things they are most concerned about.
Peter, I like that you have helped us understand what's happening at a global level and what are the key risk factors to look out as a business if you're operating in Africa. What about the consumer? Because it's the consumer who actually spends in these businesses. Is the consumer shielded from global geopolitical risks as well as government inherent risks and business inherent risks in the different countries?
So it varies from country to country. But I think what we see, and although it wasn't a focus of our own survey, what we know is that what happens on an ongoing basis, whether it's policy formulation or developments on the geopolitical scene, tends to affect eventually consumer spending patterns. If inflation starts to tick up, consumers then make a decision based on if I've got a limited amount of money, and most of us have a limited amount of money to spend, then you have to decide what becomes priority for you. Okay. So yes, of course, consumers will continue to be impacted. How shielded they are, that will vary from country to country and the policies that the various governments pursue.
Now let's scale into Kenya. How does Kenya rank, or how would you look at Kenya with regards to the global and Africa business agenda?
So when we conducted this the survey, we surveyed 171 CEOs across the African continent. And so Kenya was part of that sampling. On the East African side, we had about 30 CEOs responding to the survey. Given the size of Kenya in this part of the world, you can expect that it was very heavily represented in that survey. So it specifically in terms of the survey, I think you can take that the CEO survey and the sentiments being expressed by CEOs on the African continent is also reflective of what the CEOs in Kenya would tell us if we surveyed them specifically, because they were part of that, they were part and parcel of that sample. So the issues that we tackle in our survey will probably feature quite prominently if we surveyed Kenyan CEOs.
Okay. Peter, you are responsible for the PwC operations in Kenya as well as within the region. What is your sense with regards to business confidence? Is Kenya getting better? Is Kenya getting worse? What are CEOs thinking about, and yourself as well?
There are a lot of things that are going right, but there are also things that we know as Kenyans we need to fix. And I don't even need to go into that. We debate them on an ongoing basis. So things like policy and what policies are we going to pursue, and is there certainty as to where we are headed as a country, I think that's something that we need to get better at doing. And CEOs have expressed themselves quite clearly in that survey. And if we take the Africa CEOs survey results as representative of what CEOs would say in Kenya, then we know that's an area we need to look at. I think the issue of skills, the skills gaps that CEOs have raised, is one that we need to pay attention to. That is not something that's going to be solved just by government. I think businesses need to work very closely with government to be able to address that challenge. There are already initiatives that are in place that are going on. And government listens. It's not a question of that government doesn't absolutely listen to business. It does, and there are a lot of fora where we as business as well engage with government. I think it's the speed with which we move that is going to position this country as a competitive destination to attract all the sort of investments that are coming into the continent.
I think as we're coming to the end of our question and answer session, Peter, you did allude to the element of artificial intelligence earlier on in your briefing, and you also alluded to the fact that Kenya has been recognized with regards to its innovativeness and the support that the government is giving. What are your comments on this?
One has to commend government on the African continent. If you look at it, whether it is the Transform Africa initiative that has been put together to try and create a digital market, a one digital market on the African continent. The Kenya government is very active on that forum, and I want to congratulate them for taking the lead in trying to drive that agenda. In terms of supporting innovation, particularly around ICT, I think you have to commend the government. It's not possible for Kenya to have performed the way it's performed in terms of innovation and the ranking that it's returning around innovation if government wasn't creating the environment for that to happen. But I think most of it goes down to the innovative spirit and energy of the Kenyan youth particularly, and I think we have a big advantage there and an opportunity for us to drive some very interesting things.
Okay.
There's a lot going on in the country. I think there's a lot more we can do. And I'm very optimistic that, you know, the young people that are coming into the job market have what it takes to do what needs to be done on the global stage.
Peter, thank you so much for your time. Is there anything that is pertinent to the Africa business agenda that you would like to bring out as we come to the close of our show?
I think for me is just to say that sentiment is one thing. It's something expressed at a point in time. By the time we do this survey next year, who knows? What we do know for sure is that technological transformation will continue to shape business, and it's important that for us as businesses in Kenya and in the region, we embrace the technological advances that are happening and see how we create value out of those transformations so that we can expand the job market, reskill our people, and shape this country and the region to be able to compete on a global scale.
There you have it, the Africa Business Agenda 2019 report launched by PwC. Key things to look out for: technological transformation to be able to help African businesses to weather the volatility in the short term. Long term, the African business case and investment case, for your information, still remains very robust, but there's still a little bit of headroom for the government to be able to effectively review the economic policies, and with economic reform, we could be in a better place. Thank you once again for joining us on Markets Today. See you again tomorrow at 2:30 p.m. Good afternoon.